He's a rare combination of youthful energy and veteran-like calm. Tim Duncan, quite possibly the best player in the game today. Last year, he became only the ninth rookie to be named first team All-NBA. And this year, he's led the Spurs to the finals, two wins shy of their first NBA championship. In the first two games against the Knicks, he's averaged 29 points, 15 rebounds, and 3 assists. So what, if anything, can slow his momentum and his team's? The bright lights of the big city can be blinding, especially when you set foot inside this building. Madison Square Garden will be filled with the sounds of fervent fan support, appreciation for this year's team, and their predecessors' achievements. By now, it seems unlikely that the Spurs or their young star will let the Garden crowd or anything else play with their minds. But at this point, it may be the Knicks' best hope. Game 3, next.
This is the NBA on NBC. The 1999 NBA Finals. Tonight, Game 3. The San Antonio Spurs versus the New York Knicks.
Madison Square Garden in New York, the building Michael Jordan referred to as the Mecca of basketball. But the Garden has not seen an NBA champion in 26 years, and tonight their Knicks come home down 0-2, a deficit that has been overcome only twice in the long history of the NBA Finals. And if the Knicks are to do it, they must do it against a team that has won a record 12 consecutive playoff games this year. Welcome to the Garden for Game 3 with Doug Collins. I'm Bob Costas. Hi, everybody. We start with a news item. Marcus Camby will start over Chris Dudley tonight for the Knicks. This is a decision that Jeff Van Gundy reached only moments ago, and we'll have more on his thinking in a moment. But besides the change to Camby, and besides the change of venue from San Antonio to New York, what can the Knicks do to change the direction of this series?
Well, Bob, the Spurs have targeted Latrell Sprewell and Allen Houston defensively, and what they said is pretty simple. Don't give Latrell Sprewell layups. They're contesting everything at the basket. We'll live with him making some outside jump shots. And you're going to see him come off a screen here, pull up, and hit that little shot. They will live with that. With Allen Houston, no threes, no layups. Let's make him shoot that little medium-range jump shot. Make you work very hard, get you in the fourth quarter, let fatigue be a factor. And you look at the combined totals, 16 of 41, 17 of 42. They have scored, but it's taken them 83 shots to score 83 points. So what do they need? A little help from their friends. Game 2, 8 of 35 for the supporting cast. And Bob, if they're going to beat the Spurs, they need 6 guys playing well, not just 2.
Trying to do all this, though, against a team which, since a 6-8 start, hasn't lost 2 games in a row in almost 4 months, has won 44 of their last 50, was the best team in the league on the road during the regular season, and in the playoffs, they're a perfect 6-0 away from San Antonio, winning their road games by a greater margin than their home games, 13 points, the average margin of difference in their road victories.
Well, the Robinson-Duncan effect has been huge on both ends of the floor, and first of all, we'll take a look at offensively. Tim Duncan reads no double team, overmatches Larry Johnson in the score. This time he runs the floor on the fast break and gets the dunk. David Robinson steps out on the floor, takes the pass, shoots the little jump shot. The Knicks say, we'll double team, take the ball out of Duncan's hands. He makes the great cut to Robinson for the easy dunk. And their combined effect then defensively is they take the ball to the basket, the block shot by Tim Duncan, no layups. The points, rebounds, assists, and blocks, so consistent. But more importantly, their defense. Knicks shooting 36%, scoring only 72 points. Bob, if you want to make it real simple, the Knicks have to score tonight.
Pessimists in New York now are asking this question, not whether the Knicks can come back and win the series, but whether they can avoid being swept. But Jeff Van Gundy says if the Knicks are thinking that way, the series is over already.
If we don't believe we can win the series, and we're just trying to avoid being swept, we'll be swept.
Over the next few hours, we'll find out if they're pushed to the brink of a sweep or if they get back into the series. Hannah Storm and the Showtime crew standing by. They're next.
NBA Showtime is brought to you by E-Trade, the number one place to invest online.
Hi, everybody. Hannah Storr back at Madison Square Garden along with Isaiah Thomas, Peter Vesey, and Bill Walton. As you saw moments ago, Marcus Camby making his first start of the season for the Knicks. Isaiah, you wanted Camby in the starting lineup, but you wanted Charlie Ward out of it in favor of that bigger backcourt.
Yeah, Hannah, it doesn't solve the problem. Size is the problem for the New York Knicks. And when you look at Larry Johnson in a low post trying to guard Tim Duncan with no double team, it's impossible for him to do that. Then you're asking Larry Johnson to come back and go against David Robinson and Tim Duncan on the inside. You got to get Larry Johnson back to the small forward position where he was effective at in the Eastern Conference Finals, and also go with the big backcourt of Latrell Sprewell and Allen Houston so you can create mismatches.
Well, Bill, the Knicks' problems are on offense where they're averaging only 72 points a game. Presumably the thinking here is to get another scorer in the starting lineup with Camby.
Yes, Hannah, but calling for adjustments here incorrectly assumes that New York problems are about coaching and strategy. At this point, it's about who's got a game and who doesn't. Latrell Sprewell, he can't go to his left. He's got no three-point shot. His shot selection has been horrific. Marcus Camby, gifted athletically but exposed skill-wise. He's been thrown in a trash heap just like the Lakers and the Blazers. And then Chris Childs, he's played so poorly that people are almost begging for Charlie Ward back in there. How sad is that? But what the Knicks really need, they need better decision-making, they need greater teamwork, and they need the ability to control the tempo out there. Peter, if the Knicks don't get this one tonight, it's over.
I think Van Gundy is groping. To go with Camby at this stage of the game shows me a little panic. Why would he go with him? In the first game, he almost fouled out in 23 minutes. In game two, 32 minutes, he did foul out. Van Gundy's asking him to be so much more active, it might backfire, Bill.
Peter, Van Gundy just told me he's going with Marcus Camby because he needs a finisher out there for as long as he can last.
Isaiah, he's got five scorers in the starting lineup, basically. Now, if the Knicks start off poorly, who do you go for a lift?
Well, you forget about starting off poorly. You got to keep up with San Antonio because they're so good defensively. And if you can't score, they'll definitely shut you down. The last game, Peter, they only scored 67 points. So you got to keep up with San Antonio.
The Knicks just continuing to try to compensate for the loss of Patrick Ewing. This is their fourth different starting lineup in eight playoff games. The Knicks' leading scorer in the finals is Latrell Sprewell. He's averaging 22.5 points, but it's taken him 23 shots a game to get there. Peter asked Sprewell about the challenge of playing the Spurs.
Talk about the frustration of going up against Tim Duncan and David Robinson.
I don't look at it as frustration. I love it. It's a challenge. I mean, it's fun. This is what it's about. I mean, you got to take it at them or they're going to smack it in your face. They're good. There's no doubt about it. That's what drives me. That's why in game two I'm coming out with all this energy and this playing with all this fire to help motivate myself as well as my teammates because, you know, it's a huge task that we have to try to get over to beat these guys.
That's right. And a lot of people are talking sweep. What's in your mind?
No sweep.
Try to win.
I mean, to me, game three is important because if we can get this game, it obviously eliminates all that talk about sweep. And then we can start thinking, hey, let's even this thing up. And that's why we need to get game three.
At halftime, more of Sprewell's conversation with Peter. Game three of the NBA Finals between the Spurs and Knicks is coming up. New York's Twin Towers light up the Manhattan skyline. Will the Spurs' Twin Towers, Duncan and Robinson, light up the Knicks as they did in games one and two? The player introductions and the tip-off are next. The NBA Finals continue on NBC right after these messages.
The NBA on NBC is brought to you by Original Coors. There's only one mile-high taste. Coors, the original. By Hewlett-Packard Business PCS. Engineered on a human level. And by the irresistible taste that makes you say, did somebody say McDonald's?
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Madison Square Garden, the world's most famous arena. Tonight's game features the Western Conference champion San Antonio Spurs. and your Eastern Conference champion, New York Knicks. The head coach of the San Antonio Spurs is Greg Popovich. Now for the Western Conference champion Spurs starting lineup. At guard at 5'11 from Southern University, number 6, Avery Johnson. At guard at 6'5 from American International, number 17, Mario Elie. At forward at 7 feet from Wake Forest, number 21, Tim Duncan. Forward at 6'8 from Arizona, number 32, Sean Elliott. And at center at 7'1 from Navy, number 50, David Robinson. The head coach for your New York Knicks is Jeff Van Gundy.
Tactic. Hey, where are you going? I said over here. This is unbelievable. You cannot be serious. All right. Hey, can you open the door, please? Thanks. That's very nice. Wonderful. All right, listen, no hard feelings, okay? I'm going to the Knick game now. Take me to the garden. Take me to the garden, baby.
Here had no idea that Marcus Camby was going to start. A reaction of both surprise and approval. Let's check in with Ahmad Rashad.
All right, thanks, Bob. The San Antonio Spurs are one of the most confident teams that I have seen. While playoff basketball is usually a game-to-game adjustment, the San Antonio Spurs have not made any adjustments in the entire series. John Elliott told me that they are just that confident. He also said Game 3 is their target game. That's where they can put a game the other team away mentally. Now, also there's been some talk about Tim Duncan being intimidated by playing here in the Garden. I asked him what he thought about the Garden. He looked at me very calmly and said, nice rims. Let's go down to Jim Gray.
All right, thank you very much, Ahmad. Well, I spoke to Jeff Van Gundy, and here is the reason that he made the change, Camby for Dudley. He said that he did not like the pattern in the first two games, that no one was paying attention to Dudley at all offensively. He felt as though his elbow was hurting him, and he made this change, he said, not to please anybody. He has never made a single coaching decision, he said, to please his critics or because of any criticism. He feels that this simply gives his team the best opportunity to win, and that's how he explained it to the team. I then went on to ask Van Gundy if he truly felt that the Knicks could win this series. And he told me if he were an outsider looking in and not coaching the Knicks, that he would say no way, no chance. But because he's on the inside, he feels his team can beat the Spurs tonight. And since they can win tonight, he feels as though they can win the series. Bob?
Jim, thanks a lot. Only two teams in the history of the NBA have come back from an OT deficit to win the final. The 1969 Celtics and the 77 Blazers. The difference is the 69 Celtics were the last hurrah of the NBA's greatest dynasty. The 77 Blazers were one of the best single-season teams in league history. This is an eighth seed, injury-racked, that only found itself in the last few weeks of the regular season against a team that has won 44 of its last 50. Can't imagine a bigger hill to climb. But they've got to start right now. Robinson. Ball knocked away. Camby was there on him defensively. Houston fires. The Garden just waiting to erupt as soon as a Knicks shot goes down.
See, I think something to watch for New York in this first 10 minutes is they're going to expend a lot of energy. Are they going to get results or just get tired? We're going to see what happens here. Can they stay close?
Mariotti juggles it out of bounds. 22 free passes given out by Mariotti. I don't think one of his comps caught that ball when it squirted into the first row, but he's from New York City, went to Power Memorial High School, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar's school. Had to come up with 22 tickets tonight. Larry Johnson. Tough shot. Gets the bounce. Charlie Ward all over Avery Johnson. Ellie is open for the set shot. Rebound out of bounds to New York.
You know, I talked to Steve Kerr before the game. He said one of the things that no one said much about is the pressure the point guards defensively have put on Avery Johnson. He said it's really caused them problems offensively. So we'll watch that tonight. Even though they're not scoring, they are doing a good job defensively.
Johnson baseline against Duncan with the fadeaway. And Duncan takes the rebound. Duncan lost it. Johnson was fronting him, and the pass got over Johnson. Looked like Duncan would be home free, but he lost the ball.
You can see San Antonio are off to a little bit of a shaky start, some unforced turnovers. We've not seen this from them, Bob, in the playoffs.
Two turnovers, 0 for 2 from the floor. And Houston is fouled. The officials are Dick Pavetta, Hugh Hollins, and Ronnie Nunn.
See, one of the things that has to happen tonight also, too, is that free throw disparity between the two teams has got to be closed down. New York has got to shoot some more free throws. They got to keep San Antonio off the line. 66 to 35 in attempts in this series. That's really been the major factor.
San Antonio with double the Knicks free throw attempts and double their assists, even though the field goals are virtually even, indicating the greater ball movement that the Spurs have had. Quick foul here on Ellie. So Mario Ellie, with an inauspicious start in front of his hometown fans, goes out with two fouls.
Well, you can see the free throw shooting when I talked about. The Spurs are not shooting a very good percentage, but look at the disparity there. That is something that you're going to see here tonight. They've got it. New York has got to get to the foul line.
Ellie picks up a technical. So in less than 2 minutes, he turned the ball over. Missed a wide open shot, picked up two fouls plus a technical, and now takes a seat.
We know he's a very emotional player, but they need him on the floor. Jaren Jackson, though, has been sort of their wild card in games 3 and 4 on the road. He shot the ball so well, we'll have to watch him tonight.
And again, the whistle blows almost immediately. And Dick Pavetta is motioning toward his partners. There's a clock problem. They want to reset the clock. Pavetta over to the scorer's table. There's Greg Popovich, age 50, coach of the Spurs, also their general manager. Competed against you for a spot on the 1972 Olympic team when he came out of the Air Force Academy.
Yeah, I remember Greg back then. I was very fortunate to make that team, but as a guy who's worked himself up through the ranks coaching-wise and having the time of his life right now, Bob, in the finals with his team up 2-0.
Yeah, you were fortunate, all right. All-American and number one pick in the entire NBA draft. All luck, huh? Houston against against Jaren Jackson, who has replaced Ellen. Slides inside of it.
You can already see the aggression of New York getting to the basket, something we did not see in San Antonio.
Duncan gets San Antonio on the board.
Well, you get that deep in the post, there's nothing you can do. He just had his man sealed, and Bob, we've seen that so often.
Elliott guarding Sprewell. Allen Houston's jumper.
See, Allen has gotten easier shots. He's not playing one-on-one. In San Antonio, they're playing one-on-one. They're posting him here.
Avery Johnson flies to the hoop, taking it the length of the floor. Sprewell just holding it. Shot clock down to 11. Houston breaks free, but he's smothered by Duncan. It'll be Nick Ball with 8 seconds on the shot clock. Sprewell from the head of the key, way off. Robinson has it.
See the pressure there of the guards. It's forcing a lot of time on the clock to be used up. Bob, they're under 10 here on the clock.
Jaren Jackson tries the reverse. And Houston comes out of the pack with the ball. Sprewell in the open floor where he's most dangerous. Finding Ward. And now they set it up. Here's Camby. Robinson's on him. And after the contact, there's a foul on the Admiral.
So that's exactly what Jim Gray was talking about in his conversation with Jeff Van Gundy. David Robinson would not guard Chris Dudley out there. He has to be concerned with Camby, and Camby has the quickness to put it on the floor and drive it to the basket.
It was said that with Dudley out there, the Knicks were playing 4-on-5, but considering the production of the Knicks point guards, at times it was 3-on-5. No whistle, lots of contact inside, they let it go. Back come the Spurs. Duncan against Johnson. Missing over him, rebound Camby. Between them, Charlie Ward and Chris Childs have one fewer assists through two games than David Robinson does. Johnson's alone, but can't cash it in. He gets it back. But a loose ball foul is called on Camby.
What San Antonio's philosophy here, Bob, is to take this big emotional rush that New York is giving them, hang in there, keep their poise, stay around. It's only a 7-4 game right now, so a lot of energy expended. They're only down 3. They have to like where they are right now.
Avery Johnson penetrates and lays it in.
Sprewell had his back turned that time defensively, did not see Avery Johnson. Now, Avery Johnson's had 2 layups. So the Spurs have 3 baskets, Bob, 2 layups and a dunk. That's not a good sign with your interior defense.
Timeout New York after nearly 5 minutes. They lead by 1. This is Patrick Ewing's second trip to the NBA Finals. The first in 1994 ended in disappointment. This time, of course, Patrick's on the outside looking in. His injured Achilles is too severe for any Willis Reed-like comebacks in this final.
I wish I could, but I can't risk ripping it all away. If I rip it all away, I'll be 39 trying to come back, and my career will probably be over. It's been hard, you know. I've been having headaches because, you know, I just want to play, and, you know, I'm looking and seeing where I could help the team.
One name will be removed from this list in the next several days. Lenny Wilkins, bottom right, got a championship as the coach of the Sonics in 1979, but never as a player. After the timeout, Knicks with a 1-point lead. Here's Allen Houston. Off the glass, count the basket, plus the foul.
Santa Antonio must have seen something on the film because they've run this play about four times now. This little cross screen for Allen Houston. They're looking to post him rather than have him play one-on-one on the perimeter. He's been very effective down there, the score and the three-point play opportunity. Bob, when you score like this, you don't expend a lot of energy. You don't have to be able to take your guy off the dribble and be run into a shot blocker. Allen very fresh right now on a nice roll offensively.
Not that Houston can't score and be a threat against anybody, but remember, it's Jaren Jackson on him now, with Ellie, an excellent defender, forced to the bench with two quick fouls.
That's a very good point, because they like Ellie's toughness down there and his quickness.
Robinson against Camby. Elliott on the perimeter, back to the Admiral with the hook that's good. Camby actually got a piece of it, but he was strong enough to retain control and complete his shot.
See, people talk about that Indiana series, what Camby did. He's playing two big men now who are agile, quick, and have speed. They did not have that in Indiana.
Sprewell's jumper is good.
See, the big thing here, though, Bob, is it's Sprewell and Houston again doing all the scoring. Eventually, some of these other guys are going to have to give them some help.
Robinson back into the paint. And a whistle for a foul.
If that's Camby, that's his second, and he will be in foul trouble. It'll be a chance to get down to a two-point game. So this is where starting Marcus Camby could backfire against you.
It is Camby. It's his second.
See, again, he's playing against the guy who's going to lean in and draw contact. So two fouls now. Now you got to come in with Kurt Thomas. Camby sits down. Robinson makes both of these free throws. It's only a two-point game. So that's the risk you run starting Camby.
Camby to the bench, as Doug said, with Thomas in. To back up your earlier point about the overemphasis on Sprewell and Houston for the Knicks. In game two, Sprewell had 26 points. Houston had 19. No other Knick had more than six.
Well, you know, it's taken him 83 shots to get 83 points. We talked in our open. Somebody else has got to help him here.
Well, Sprewell can't get it done here, but he's coming to the foul line.
See, games one and two, look at this, 87 points for Robinson and only 56 shots, so their point efficiency because they shoot 40 free throws. But you see what's free will in Houston. They have not gotten to the free throw line. They've not shot as high a percentage. And again, Bob, the whole philosophy for San Antonio is try to wear them down through the course of time. And somebody from New York is going to have to start making some shots for them. Larry Johnson got one early, but it's been Sprewell in Houston.
Ellie goes out with two fouls. Jaren Jackson, his replacement, immediately picks up a couple. He sits down. And this is a very early entrance for Antonio Daniels.
Well, now they have a definite matchup problem because Antonio Daniels is undersized. So whoever they post, they're going to have to go back and double team. This might free up some shooting.
Here's Avery Johnson finding Robinson. Pump fake, then the jumper. Rebound Sprewell. Allen Houston. Kurt Thomas recovers it. Duncan on Johnson. Sprewell faking, putting it on the floor, in the lane, got it.
That's such a tough shot. Sean Elliott played great defense, and Sprewell just got to the lane and hit that little medium range jump shot.
Knicks by six. Duncan against two defenders. The rebound to Thomas. Johnson from Houston. Johnson with 4 points. The Knicks up eight. Timeout San Antonio.
Well, Houston and Sprewell have gotten off to a terrific start. You see 14 points on only 9 shots. They've both gotten to the line twice and converted. Allen Houston in the post, something we have not seen a lot of, the up and under move. And they go back to it once again in the 3-point play. Sprewell. well with that little lightning first step, the step back jump shot. And this is a tough shot where he drives it, pulls up, pump fakes, gets in the air, and scores. We talked about the importance of these two guys as the series has gone on, especially with injuries to Ewing and Larry Johnson. You see the percentage of their points. The problem, they have not shot a high percentage. Tonight, a good start for them.
This is the Knicks' biggest lead of the finals. They had a six-point lead at one juncture in San Antonio. They're up eight now. Antonio Daniels. Duncan screening for him. Cutting in front for the steal is Ward. He's gone. He went to the reverse, though. The follow isn't there. Sprewell, a third drive, and puts it in.
Well, San Antonio's going to get back on defense. That time, Sprewell and Allen Houston both got shots at the basket because Houston did not get back. Now, Bob, with this offensive team that San Antonio has on the floor, they've got to attack the post defensively in New York, make Antonio Daniels shoot the ball.
Robinson's hook puts an end to an 8-0 New York run.
So you got to swarm those big guys right now. Now you've got to change your strategy because you've got two non-shooters on the perimeter in Daniels and Avery Johnson.
Knicks working around the perimeter. Ward to Thomas. Thomas into traffic, hits with the left hand.
Bob, in the first two games, we saw the ball sticking on one side of the floor. It's changing sides of the floor, causing San Antonio to move their feet defensively.
Daniels got it from Duncan and was fouled. Antonio Daniels is in his second year in the league. He was the fourth pick in the entire draft by Vancouver coming out of Bowling Green a year ago. Didn't do all that well as a rookie, was dealt to San Antonio, has been Avery Johnson's backup at the point for much of the season, but really has not gotten many minutes in the playoffs. The pass inside for Johnson, but an offensive foul on the Spurs gives it back to the Knicks. Johnson pushed off to free himself.
There's so much of an overplay. They're trying not to let Avery Johnson catch the ball because he's the guy who enters their offense. Charlie Ward putting all kinds of pressure. That was a set play. He got called for the foul.
Knicks by 10 as we approach 3 minutes. Johnson left alone. They dare him to hit it, and he can't.
Too much time. You start thinking that much, you will not make that shot.
Sean Elliott. The basket will count. It's a three-pointer. And there's a New York foul on top of it.
I think they just wiped it off.
First, they said it would count.
Yes, yes.
Now the officials are conferring. Avery Johnson arguing on the floor. Popovich arguing from the bench. And Popovich may have just been hit with a technical.
See, instead of a four-point play, it's a loose ball foul, sideline out of bounds. You're not in the penalty. So that's a big play. That could be a four-point play right there, and then a technical. I guess maybe they haven't called a technical. Oh, they have called, so they've got to shoot the technical and they get the ball sideline out of bounds. This could be a five-point swing here.
The technical was on Popovich, the personal on Kurt Thomas. The question was whether Sean Elliott's three would count. The initial indication was yes. Then they waved it off, said the foul came before the release. Houston shoots the technical and increases the Knicks' lead to 23-12.
Duncan's going to pass the ball out of the double team. You see the loose ball on the other side, and Elliott lets it go. And they've called the foul before the shot was taken. That was a good play, a good call to wipe that off. See, Ronnie Nunn had counted it, but Dick Pavetta waved it off, said the foul occurred before the shot.
Antonio Daniels fires a three and hits it.
That's a big shot because Allen Houston is going to go back to help defensively. If he makes that shot, look out.
Houston's turnaround. And the rebound to Robinson. who is immediately fouled by Kurt Thomas.
You have to use your fouls judiciously if you're in New York, Bob. You can't commit those silly over-the-back fouls. Look for an opening. Dart in there. Try to get to the boards. You just can't jump over somebody's back. Now, Kurt Thomas is going to have to sit down. So you start Camby. He gets two fouls. Thomas gets two. Now you have to come in with Dudley. Now you got some problems. Now you are playing 4-on-5 offensively.
Robinson cuts the Spurs deficit to 7. You can log on to MSNBCSports.com for much more on the NBA Finals, a special section called NBA Showtime online. Isaiah Thomas and Bill Walton can be found there. That's MSNBCSports.com, the official website of NBC Sports.
New York has played a terrific first quarter. They lead by 6, a little over 2 minutes. Bob, end of quarters has really hurt them. Can they come out here with a big first quarter?
They're begging for some offense from Ward and or Childs. They're 2-point guards.
Well, Sprewell and Houston got them out of the gate quickly. They're playing well. That confidence should go down to the rest of the players. It looks like it's doing that right now.
Tim Duncan against two defenders. Robinson on the other side of the rim, and he was fouled.
When you go to block shots away from the basketball, what that does is free up the offensive rebound. And we know that San Antonio is not a good offensive rebounding team. Bob, they have 9 in the series. Duncan has 8 of them. When you get shot blockers going over there, you're going to get a chance for some second shots. That's what happened that time with Robinson,
who has spent much of this first quarter at the free throw line. He's 5 for 5. Avery Johnson out, Steve Kerr in for San Antonio. And Chris Childs replaces Charlie Ward at the point for the Knicks.
Now, it's interesting, but in the previous series, Chris Childs had been the guys playing so well, and Ward had struggled. In this series, actually, Ward has played better. Childs has struggled. They need him to play well today. He's 3 for 16 in this series. Got to play better.
1 of 2 for Robinson, New York by 7. Allen Houston, catch and shoot. And him.
Pretty basketball, but he started inside, and he's moved outside.
Houston with 11 first quarter points. Antonio Daniels to Robinson. Sprewell went for the steal, didn't get it. Sean Elliott left alone. His 3 spins out. Here's Houston. Giving it up to Sprewell and a whistle for a San Antonio foul.
Allen Houston does a great job without the basketball. He sets his man up, comes off the screen, beautiful catch and shoot. And the thing about Allen is he's got some baskets here early in the game. And more importantly, layups, free throws lead to the jump shot being a lot easier for you. So now he's scoring from everywhere. That's a very positive sign.
Has 3 assists in this first quarter. He had 3 total assists in the first 2 games in San Antonio.
The Knicks have moved the ball better in this first quarter than we've seen in the entire series. They're getting it from one side of the floor to the other, Bob. They're not just catching it and playing one-on-one basketball where the Spurs can load up on them and send them into those shot blockers.
Inside a minute to play in the first. Tim Duncan scored the Spurs' first basket of the game and hasn't scored since. Duncan's pass to Elliott. The defense caused him to miss. Sprewell lets it go. And Duncan claims the rebound.
I guess he was looking for 2 for 1, but I don't like that shot from Sprewell. He's not a 3-point shooter. You're in the foul problems. Drive that ball to the basket.
Robinson can't hit it. Childs takes it.
The fans here yelling, last shot, let them know there's about a half-second differential on the shot clock.
Sprewell, wide open Childs. That's his first 3 of the finals. He was their second-best 3-point shooter for the year. 3 seconds, Daniels.
What a big shot. Antonio Daniels off the bench with 6 points. That was a big shot. Now, instead of a 14-point lead, it's 11.
And the buzzer. Antonio Daniels, almost a forgotten man, really. He played himself out of the rotation earlier in the playoffs, but what a contribution here tonight.
Well, Allen Houston, 13 points, and Bob, we talked about it. What does New York have to do tonight? They have to score some points, averaging 76 points. They've already got 32 in the first quarter.
And you're watching the NBA Finals on NBC.
Throughout this series, New York has kept the ball on one side of the floor. But look what happens when you have to double team. Ball goes in here, it's pass, pass, pass. Follow it into screen roll, and this guy actually is the one who scores. This is what New York needs to do to make those big guys move around. Now Duncan double team, now he's got to try to show him the screen roll. He can't get there, and you've got the shot blockers out of there and the score from Kurt Thomas. That's very, very good offense by New York, all created by the posting of Allen Houston and the double team.
Looking at the first road games of each of the playoff series so far for San Antonio, they either held slim leads or were down, in the case of Game 3 at Portland, by a slim margin. Here, they trailed by 11, and it would have been 14 had Antonio Daniels not buried a three just before the buzzer. New York ball at the outset of the second.
Great matchup here for Larry Johnson against Malik Rose. This is a guy he can post if he'll take his time.
He spins baseline. Goes to the bank, and a foul on the play. Meanwhile, through the first two games in San Antonio, the Knicks had more turnovers than assists. In the first quarter tonight, easily their best period of the series. That's an understatement, leading 32-21. Six assists for the Knicks, no turnovers.
Well, game two, first half, 34 points. Second half, 33. Tonight, 32 in the first quarter. But they cannot have any droughts. They're known for their scoring droughts.
15 on the shot clock. Foul a moment ago was on Malik Rose, his first. Popping out for the catch and shoot is Sprewell, but it rattles out on him. Sean Elliott guarded by Houston. Elliott has been quiet offensively in this series. Here's Duncan against two defenders, banks it in, plus the foul.
Now, interesting matchup there, and I don't know if it was just because it was on the break, but they've got Larry Johnson guarding Duncan there instead of Dudley. That's a mismatch. I don't know why Dudley's not playing him unless they just got caught running up and down the floor, but Duncan wheels in there. You see the strength of Tim Duncan. That's one of the things that Jeff Van Gundy talked to us about. He said, I didn't realize, or our players didn't realize, how strong Duncan was. They're finding out now.
Three-point play brings the Spurs to within eight. Here's Houston for Dudley.
You got to foul him. The guy's got a bad arm. Why you let him lay the ball in the basket? Tim Duncan's got to take that foul.
Not much of a foul shooter with two good arms. Has the hyperextended right elbow and has been considering shooting free throws left-handed. Something he might have thought of earlier in his career, all things considered. Here's Duncan spinning and missing. But it pops into Kerr's hands. Daniels. Kerr, the jumper. They're still waiting for him to get on track. He hits his first shot tonight.
Well, in the playoffs, he's 5 for 24 going into game tonight, so that's a big shot. They need all they can get from the perimeter.
Sprewell returns it to Dudley. Dudley travels.
If you have to pump fake and start doing all that with your head and stuff, you got to kick that ball out of there. And that's what Chris Dudley did. He got called for the violation.
The first New York turnover of the game.
Mario Elliott back in the game now with two fouls as Sean Elliott will take a rest.
And Houston has gone out. They have two point guards on the floor now, Childs and Ward, both out there.
See, the reason they can do that is because San Antonio's small in the backcourt with Kerr and Daniels.
Duncan backing in on Dudley. And banking it home.
Just such great patience. His maturity level for a second-year player is really amazing.
Trailing by 14 a few moments ago, San Antonio now within six. Mario Scully back in, guarding Sprewell, who explodes past him, then comes up short with the shot. Johnson is there to clean up the mess.
See, Larry Johnson cannot get those shots off if you have both David Robinson and Duncan in the game. With Malik Rose in there, they should go inside to Larry Johnson now.
Kerr again. Back rims it. Rebound swatted around, and Sprewell comes out with it. Sprewell trying to blow by his defender. Kerr reached in. There was a foul on the play against San Antonio.
Dribble penetration forces the defense to help. Allen Houston loses sight of Steve Kerr just enough for that quick release jump shot as Steve Kerr gets a desperately needed jump shot for San Antonio. And then Tim Duncan, the footwork, the fake, the little head fake, gets the defense leaning, kicks it off the glass. And David Robinson says, you know what, I'm resting now. I like what I see. I'll be in here to help you soon.
The NBA on NBC is brought to you by Gatorade Thirst Quencher, helping you play longer and stronger when it counts the most. Gatorade, is it in you? By Honda, a winning lineup of cars, sport utility vehicles, and minivans. And by Adidas, long live sport.
Here's Hersey Hawkins in the crowd at Madison Square Garden. The supersonic veteran won this year's NBA Sportsmanship Award. Always a gentleman, always doing a lot of charity work. Presentation was made today in New York. Charlie Ward with it as play resumes. Here's Chris Childs out of the pack to Johnson. Now Ward for three. Had a good look at it, couldn't put it down. Duncan snatches the rebound. Ellie lobs to Duncan, guarded by Dudley. Sprewell over to help. Malik Rose in the paint against Johnson, way short. Kerr cuts in front but can't save it. It's New York ball. And David Robinson's coming back.
David Robinson, this is the way you want to rest your players if you can. A little over 3 minutes he actually missed, but over 11-minute rest, as Duncan will set. He never wants to come out of the game, so I'm sure he's telling Popovich, don't let me sit over here very long.
Childs from behind Dudley's screen. It rattles in and out. The rebound to Malik Rose. Robinson to Rose, blocked by Dudley. He's got it back. Daniels off the dribble. Antonio Daniels on fire here.
You know, it's been amazing in the playoffs. It's been somebody make timely shots for San Antonio, Bob, whether it be Jaren Jackson, Sean Elliott. Tonight, Antonio Daniels pulls them to the within six. An offensive foul here as New York sort of coming unglued a little bit. They've only scored 4 points in 4 minutes and 18 seconds.
Meanwhile, here's Antonio Daniels, 3 for 3 from the floor, a pair of threes, and this tough jumper off the dribble.
The young guy's got some talent. He's probably saying, what am I doing out here? I have not played. But I think what's happened is Pop has gone to his bench earlier, realizing this is going to be such a frenetic game. He's trying to keep his players fresh.
Robinson spinning on Dudley, who fouled him.
How about as a coach now, Bob? You're coaching, and you said, you know what? I think I'll take Tim Duncan out of the game, and I'll bring David Robinson in for him. How many guys have that kind of option? See, the quickness of David Robinson as the ball goes inside. He makes that quick spin move, and Charlie Ward is slow getting there.
With seconds to play in the first quarter, New York led by 14. Even though Robinson missed the first, as Duncan watches from the bench, if he hits this one, he draws his team to within five.
Well, New York's going to take a timeout after this free throw when they get the ball across half court. And I'm sure Jeff Van Gundy's going to say, look, guys, we're losing all this momentum that we worked so hard for. It was 32-21. We've been outscored 11-4 here in this quarter. We've got to get some scoring. Keep attacking that basket.
And you're watching the NBA Finals on NBC.
The man tonight for San Antonio has been Antonio Daniels. See, the first two games, 2 minutes, 2 points. Tonight, 8 points in 11 minutes. This was a big jump shot here. Three, and then he follows it up right at the end of the quarter. Instead of a 14-point New York lead, 11. Then a little pull-up jump shot. So 8 points. Timely shooting. With Ellie getting in early foul trouble, they've gone to their bench, and Antonio Daniels has really come up big for them here early in this game. He plays horse before the games with Tim Duncan, and Ahmad said tonight he beat him, so maybe he boosted his confidence a little bit.
A sign of things to come, perhaps. Dick Pavetta says, hold on, right away off the inbound.
Jim Gray said out of the New York timeout, they said they got to move the basketball like they did earlier, and they got to play better defense. So starting to get stuck again, Bob, offensively, where that ball's keeping in one guy's hand and not getting moved around the perimeter.
Apparently another problem with the shot clock, which, as you see, didn't budge off 24. 7:21 to play in the half. The Knick lead is 5. This is the first time since 1981 when Del Harris coached the Rockets into the finals and Bill Fitch was the Celtics coach that both coaches in the NBA finals hadn't played in the league, Popovich and Van Gundy.
Well, again, both of them have been career coaches. These guys started out in high school. They've coached at small colleges and all. So, you know, Bob, if anybody deserves it, they played their dues. These two guys have done that.
Here's Johnson. Score. 8 points for Larry Johnson.
See how the ball changed sides of the floor? It started on the right, came back into the left, post up. That makes those big guys stay at home.
Pass deflected into the backcourt by Charlie Ward, so no violation as Daniels chases it down, but now they've got 6 seconds to shoot. Avery Johnson, 2 seconds to get a shot off. Johnson on the run, beats the buzzer in Kansas. Avery Johnson told his whole career that he can't. 2 victories from earning an NBA championship ring. Houston around Ellie and fouled by either Ellie or Duncan, who came over to help. Antonio Daniels was also there.
Well, Avery Johnson with the shot clock, he looks up and he sees these. I've got to get to the basket. And as his left-hand player, so he wheels in the lane and shoots a little floating hook shot. That's actually his shot. The ball out of his hands, you see clearly it beats the buzzer. And he brings the Spurs to within 5.
And the foul a moment ago was on Antonio Daniels, his second.
You know, Bob, interesting story. Last year, Avery Johnson was at the finals also, but he was there to get the award that Hersey Hawkins just got. They asked him one question and said, move aside so we can talk to the players. He said, next time I'm back here, you're going to have to ask me some more questions. Well, I think they have this year.
Houston's been perfect at the free throw line in these NBA finals. 13 for 13. Ronnie Nunn whistles an illegal defense. That's a warning. The second one results in a technical foul. Spurs trail by 7 as they put it back in. Robinson driving on Dudley. Little contact, they let it go, and the Admiral connects off the glass.
He's a lefty, but he wants to drive right, and Dudley's been told, don't let him get to the basket with his right hand.
Chris Childs out to Johnson with 7 on the shot clock. Johnson in the paint. Double pump fadeaway.
Look what I found. It looked like he was going to pass that ball to Dudley. Realized who it was. Said, doesn't do me any good to pass it. You can't shoot it. I might as well get it up there.
Johnson with 10 now after that improbable bucket. And Duncan lost it. Ward took it away. His pass is deflected. And Daniels has it back. Lobbing for Duncan. And Duncan slams it home. And there's a needless foul by Chris Childs.
You've got to let that one go, Bob. And also what happened is when a guy falls down on the floor and stays back on his under his own basket, you got to keep a guy back. And what happened here, Chris Dudley went running down the floor. He's got to stay back with Duncan because if you don't score, this is exactly what happens. You get a little cherry-pick layup, a dunk, and an opportunity for a three-point play.
But how in the world is Chris Childs going to stop Tim Duncan from scoring on that play? So you just give them a chance for a point and pick up a foul on yourself with no possible purpose.
And also what it does, every foul you pick up, it means the sooner you get into the penalty situation and shoot free throws. We said one of the big things has been the free throw disparity in this series. So Chris Child's got to let that one go.
Spurs have whittled 10 points off what was once a 14-point New York lead.
Bob, we talk about those droughts, and New York is famous for them. They'll go stretches. Remember in Game 2, they missed 19 of 20 shots at one time.
Famous or infamous?
Infamous, whatever.
Childs, the ball was kicked. Duncan dives to the floor to take it. And let's see what the call will be. Van Gundy wanted the kick. Childs gets up and argues for a kick.
Now, Dick Bavetta saying it didn't hit his foot, but you cannot kick your leg out to try to stop a play. That was an inadvertent. That was inadvertent. Hit his knee. That was a good no call there. And then the kick on Childs right there as he tries to kick it with his foot. That's why the Spurs got the ball. It's good refereeing by Dick Bavetta on that possession.
Avery Johnson with the floater. And the rebound taken by Thomas. Childs is hobbling as he comes out of the backcourt. Latrell Sprewell. Thomas. Ball loose. And taken by Robinson. Here's Sean Elliott, left alone. Takes it to the basket and lays it in. He hesitated on the three. Everybody in Madison Square Garden, except maybe the 22 tickets given away by Mario Elie, was sure that he had walked. They let the play go. It almost seemed to unfold in slow motion, and Elliott took it in for the layup.
Well, we saw him do the tiptoe job in Memorial Day where he hit the three from the corner. Does his foot leave the ground? Yes, it did.
Man.
That should have been a travel. Missed call there, and Sean Elliott takes advantage of it. This is a guy who's a master of the half inch, roping that sideline that he did before. But look at this now. Whoa, his feet are off the floor. Big break for San Antonio there, Bob. And New York has to call a timeout, a two-point game. And this is exactly what San Antonio wanted. Take that early flurry. They got down by 14. Just keep working at it, working at it. It's now a two-point game. And New York has only scored 10 points in this quarter after 32 in the first.
Well, if you go back to Antonio Daniels' three-pointer just a few seconds before the end of the first quarter, the Spurs have outscored the Knicks 22-10 to turn a 14-point deficit into a two-point game. In the second quarter, the Knicks have two assists and five turnovers.
They're playing more one-on-one, Bob.
In the first quarter, six assists, no turnovers. Here's Sprewell, stopping and popping.
They got to move that basketball. They cannot just come down and play one-on-one against San Antonio. That plays into their strengths.
Sprewell's got 10. Houston's got 15. This time they have help, though. Larry Johnson has 10. Robinson, blocked back in his face by Camby. Duncan takes it. The set shot from the corner. The rebound to Duncan. And he puts it back. Duncan has 12. Sprewell again. Ball tapped to the side. Elliott chasing after it. Can't save it. Nick Maugham.
Marcus Camby has to be very careful here, Bobby. Picked up two early fouls. He's got to stay away from that third night. He's got to be aggressive, but he can't pick up a silly foul.
Houston tries to curl it inside to Thomas, who gives it to Sprewell, who hands it to Camby, who blows the dunk. Houston, his pass off Thomas's hands, but then in turn, Elliott can't come up with it, and the Knicks will keep it.
Tim Duncan, San Antonio has 9 offensive rebounds in the 2 games. He has 8 of them. This is 9th. He lays the ball in the basket. And then Camby goes up strong and misses the dunk. And this reminds me a lot of the old Boston Celtics with Bill Russell. He said, you know what, I'm going to block 6 or 7 shots a game. You just don't know which ones they are.
Hi, everyone. Hannah Storm. Coming up on the Prudential Halftime Report, we'll hear from the Knicks' Latrell Sprewell. He came to New York after the attack on his former coach, P.J. Carlissimo. But he's been embraced by the fans at Madison Square Garden. Witness the celebration after the Knicks eliminated the Indiana Pacers 10 days ago.
It was our bond. I mean, like, when I get introduced or when I come off the bench as a sixth man, I mean, they're there supporting me. And so once we, you know, got past Indiana and I knew we were in, it was a way for me to give back to them or just, you know, look into their eyes.
Peter Vesey's conversation with Latrell Sprewell coming up at halftime. Right now, Sprewell has 10 points and his Knicks lead the Spurs by 2 as we rejoin Bob and Doug at courtside.
Hannah, thanks very much. And as you look at that line, the field goal percentage is better than it was in San Antonio. He's got 4 rebounds and, very importantly, 4 assists. So this is a better overall game for Sprewell.
Well, he's shooting better shots. And remember, early, he was the post feeder on Allen Houston to get those early assists as Allen was posting to start this game. Allen got off to a great start, 13 points in the first quarter, Bob, only 2 now in the second.
Allen Houston nearly lost it. Mario Elie on him tight as Houston drives, throws up the floater, no good, but a foul on the play. Chris Childs has gone to the locker room. Let's check with Jim Gray.
All right, Bob. Well, when he went down on the ground with Tim Duncan and was charged with kicking the ball, he twisted his left knee. He's now being examined by Dr. Norman Scott. They hope to have some type of evaluation either in the next 2 minutes or during halftime, and they're hopeful that he'll be able to return, but they're not sure. Bob?
Jim, thanks very much. Mario Elie was just hit with his 3rd foul. Greg Popovich shooing Elie over to the bench. He picked up a technical earlier, and he was arguing his case as he left. He's replaced by Jaren Jackson. Join NBC Saturday as the world's best tennis players gather at the All England Club for the world's most prestigious championship, Wimbledon. Following a devastating loss to Steffi Graf in the finals of the French Open, Martina Hingis takes to court 1 tomorrow, looking to regain her dominance in the majors and win her 2nd Wimbledon title. Coverage begins Saturday at 1 Eastern here on NBC.
One of the keys we talked about, free throw disparity. The Knicks tonight, 11 of 11. San Antonio, 8 of 10. They've closed the gap as Avery Johnson has called for a walk here.
It's San Antonio's feeling that with the Knicks having a thin roster, if the game is close, the 4th quarter will belong to them because of fatigue and foul trouble and various other disadvantages in terms of matchups that Jeff Van Gundy faces.
Well, that's why it's so important for New York to get everybody involved so Allen Houston and Sprewell don't expend so much energy in the first 3 quarters that they can't finish in the 4th.
Again, the 24-second clock is malfunctioning, and that's why play has stopped. Well, so far tonight, in nearly a half, New York does have the 3rd offensive option in the presence of Larry Johnson with 10 points.
Well, that's important because, as we talked about, Houston and Sprewell got them off to very good starts. And then, Bob, you need your teammates to join in, and that's what's happened tonight. They lead by 4, but more importantly, that free throw difference is really, really big.
Brings it across. They may have to count on him heavily in the second half if Childs can't go. Allen Houston. The rebound to Robinson.
Still does not have a 3-point field goal in the series.
Jaren Jackson. Hot in game 1, cold in game 2. Sean Elliott finds Robinson.
Bob, you notice tonight that the San Antonio players in the post are holding the ball longer. The reason, they must make New York make a stronger double team. Remember, Popovich told us yesterday they were passing the ball too quickly and allowing New York to recover.
Here's Sprewell over Jackson, giving New York a bit of breathing room. They're up by 4.
He's so quick, you almost hope he takes that shot. Otherwise, he's going to blow right around you. They're giving him the 15-footer.
He scored a dozen. With Thomas on him. Ward over to try to help. 4 on the shot clock. Avery Johnson lost it.
That's those breaks you talk about at home. That very easily could have been a foul on Kurt Thomas and a force out. Dick Pivetta said, no, you went out under your own power. It could have been the third foul on Kurt Thomas as it is. New York has the basketball.
Houston's pass for Sprewell. Out of the double, he finds Johnson. Johnson driving to the hoop and missing. Ball out of bounds to the Spurs with 55 seconds to play in the first half. This has been a good shooting half. The Spurs have hit 50% and New York just under that.
Well, one of the big differences in this game that we did not see in the first two games, Bob, is they're posting Sprewell and Allen Houston and going inside and then either having them score or kick the ball out. That's something we did not see in the first two games.
Sprewell with the steal and the save intended for Houston, but he can't come up with it as Johnson beats him to the loose ball. Spurs perhaps looking for a 2-for-1. Johnson with the quick jumper. That's what he had in mind.
That's a great call, Bob. Avery Johnson saw the clock. He knew what he wanted. There's about a 4.5-second differential. That's a great pickup there.
Spurs looking for the stop and the quick basket that, in theory, could tie the game at the half. 6 to shoot. And an illegal defense is called.
What got them in that situation is they were isolating at the top for Sprewell to go 1-on-1, and they ran at him to try to get the ball out of his hands. When they did, David Robinson did not get back to a legal area. So that's the second, and that will be a technical foul.
Houston remains perfect at the free throw line in the finals.
Now you say, why is Rick Brunson on the floor? Because we need another shooter. They're not going to guard Chris Dudley. So he has the ability to make a shot if they leave him open. More importantly, you have to stay with him, at least guard him.
Knicks by 3. And now the last possession is theirs. Houston pump fakes, and the jumper is overshot. Brunson trying for the tip. But it's back tapped by the Spurs, and that'll do it. Knicks led by 14 at one point. Take a slim 3-point advantage to the locker room at halftime of game 3. Van Gundy said, if we play just to avoid being swept, we will be swept. If we win tonight, we feel we're back in the series. The Prudential Halftime Report coming up. You're watching the NBA Finals on NBC.
This is the Prudential Halftime Report, brought to you by Prudential. Prudential, a leader in insurance, investments, real estate, and financial services. See why Prudential is today's rock-solid choice for your financial needs.
It's halftime of Game 3 of the NBA Finals, and after averaging just 72 points in the first two games, the Knicks have scored 49 in the first half against the Spurs. They lead it by 3. Hi, everybody. Hannah Storm back with Isaiah Thomas, Peter Vesey, and Bill Walton. We'll hear from these gentlemen in just a few moments. But first, the Knicks' Latrell Sprewell. This postseason has been the best of times for Sprewell, but it comes after a dark period. In December of 1997, Sprewell attacked his coach at Golden State, P.J. Carlissimo. The NBA suspended Sprewell for the remainder of the 97-98 season, a total of 68 games. He was then traded to the Knicks in the offseason. Peter spoke with the 3-time All-Star.
I've made mistakes, but I don't let them keep me down.
Sprewell grabbed Carlissimo by the throat and threatened to kill him.
People say, I'm what's wrong with sports.
And the National Basketball Association banned him from playing in the league.
People say, I'm America's worst nightmare. I say, I'm the American dream.
It's like everyone says I'm this, but I'm really not. I mean, I'm human. I made a mistake. I'm this person that had troubles, but I've moved on from that. And I've gotten to where I want to be in life. And that's the ultimate dream, is to, as a kid, come up and wish you were somewhere and dream about being somewhere and to actually get there. It's a dream come true.
At forward, at 6'5", Latrell Sprewell.
When you came to the Knicks, what position were you going to play?
I think he, at the time, I was going to play the three.
Is that your natural position?
Three?
Mm-hmm.
No, I don't think so.
So what does that mean? Does it mean that you're going to accept playing the three?
Yeah, I'm going to accept it, obviously.
The operative word is if. If you're here, why wouldn't you be here?
Well, I would expect to be here. I mean, I don't know. I can't tell the future. I want to be here, and I'm a part of this organization now, and that's what my heart is.
I've always gotten the feeling you like being a villain also. If you play the part of villain, do you like to start or sub?
Probably start. On the court, I'll be your villain. I mean, I'm the guy. I mean, in game two, I mean, nothing against Sean Elliott, but I'm all over the guy. I'm all in his face, in his ear, and saying whatever, just to get myself going and to let him know that he's going to be in for a long night.
Freewell is yelling at Sean Elliott. I mean, right in his face.
I'm different. That's the fire and the energy that I play with. And. You know, it's also me trying to intimidate a guy to a certain extent. And that's just me. That's the way that I play. It's the mean streak that's in me.
I would have loved to have heard what you and Jordan were talking about when you went up against each other.
Jordan? No, Jordan's the man. How can you talk to Jordan? He's accomplished so much. And hey, he's my idol anyway, so I mean.
I saw so many guys, young guys, coming up over the years that did start talking trash to him. The Miami Heat guys were
infamous. For Sean Leonard, huh? Mistake. Oh. Big mistake, right? He learned quickly, though, see? That's why I never said anything to Mike. You leave Mike alone.
Do you have any idea, you know, how big you could be in New York? I covered the Knicks when they were winning championships, and do you understand that you could be every bit as big as Walt Frazier?
That hasn't really hit me yet. I mean, and because it's something you don't really expect to happen. And if it happens, you know, obviously that'll be the greatest thing that I could ever ask for.
The celebration has begun here at Madison Square Garden. Latrell Sprewell is dancing around the four corners of the court with his arms outstretched. I think he's thanking the fans.
So that was the ultimate. I've never experienced anything like that in my life. It was a way for me to show the fans or thank them for the support that they've given me. That was for me to do. I mean, it was our bond. I mean, like, when I get introduced or when I come off the bench as a sixth man, I mean, they're there supporting me. It was a way for me to give back to them or just, you know, look into their eyes. What can you say? It's one of those moments you know you're going to always remember. And, you know, I want more of it. I'm dying for more.
Sprewell has one more year left on his Knicks contract. He told Peter that he wants to remain in New York and that if Garden President Dave Checketts asked him about playing for Jeff Van Gundy, Sprewell says he has no problems playing for him. When we return, we'll talk about the first half between the Knicks and the Spurs. First, a message from Prudential and a word from the NBA. At halftime of Game 3, the Knicks lead the Spurs 49-46. The first quarter was their highest scoring quarter of the finals so far. They broke out offensively with 32 points and had the size edge in the backcourt, Isaiah. It wasn't anything they did when they fiddled with their starting lineup. It was because of foul trouble.
Yeah, when Mario Elie got in foul trouble, it created the mismatches at the guard spot that the Knicks had been waiting for. You see Allen Houston here going over a smaller Jaren Jackson inside the post. Also now with a mismatch being guarded by Antonio Daniels, able to fake him off the screen, come up and shoot. Then you have Sprewell being double-teamed, frees up a Chris Childs, wide open for the three-point shot. Now, when the Knicks lost the lead in the second quarter, they only scored 17 points because they went to the small guard lineup. When they went to Childs and Ward, consequently, they weren't able to produce as many points as they did in the first quarter.
But you know, the fact that Ellie was in foul trouble and Jaren Jackson was being exploited by Sprewell allowed Daniels in the game. He's buried as a point guard, only played 3 or 4 minutes in this series, comes in as a shooting guard, basically, hit three huge psychological baskets for them. And Tim Duncan, he's one of the true superstars. When things are going bad at one side of the court, he can instantly make an adjustment, get over to the other side. He doesn't have to wait to see the stat sheet at the end of the game. But the Knicks are fit to be had, Hannah. They've lost the momentum. They've lost most of their lead. The crowd's out of it, and they become a jump shooting team again.
Led by as many as 14 points in the first half. Bill, meanwhile, the Spurs' strength has been their interior defense. Why wasn't that as effective for much of the first half?
Hannah, San Antonio was not sharp defensively. They were flat-footed as they stood around and watched the New York Knicks role players score inside, and that's just as not San Antonio basketball. Chris Dudley, he even scored at the hoop. Remarkable here, the layup goes down. And then Larry Johnson, ineffective throughout the series inside. Larry Johnson gets two interior baskets. Now, the interior game and offense for New York has been superior. Sprewell and Houston have outplayed Duncan and Robinson, but this is a very long game. San Antonio is organized and disciplined. I don't know if the Spurs realize just how many people they have to beat tonight in this building, Hannah.
And the Knicks don't win unless Cammy goes back to what he did in Indiana. They need more out of him than fouls.
All right, meanwhile, the Wimbledon fortnight began today with no major upsets among the seeded players. On the men's side, Pete Sampras won in straight sets. The only player to struggle was third seed Yevgeny Kafelnikov, who was tied with Magnus Larsson 5-all in the fifth set when darkness fell. On the women's side, Steffi Graf, Monica Seles, and Venus Williams all won in straight sets. Graf, by the way, will be teamed with John McEnroe in the mixed doubles. Our coverage of Wimbledon gets underway Saturday at 1 o'clock Eastern Time. We'll bring you over 35 hours of action from the All England Club. In the WNBA, one game tonight, the expansion Orlando Miracle evened its record at 3-3, beating the Phoenix Mercury 80-76. In Salt Lake, 67-year-old Frank Layton, the coach of the Utah Stars, resigned today, citing the long work days and travel. He'll be replaced by assistant Fred Williams. The inaugural WNBA All-Star Game will be held here at Madison Square Garden, home of the New York Liberty, on Wednesday night, July 14th. You can cast your vote online at WNBA.com. Our next WNBA telecast is Saturday at 4 o'clock Eastern Time, the Phoenix Mercury visiting the Detroit Shock. The Knicks lead the Spurs by 3. We'll send you back to Bob and Doug for the second half after these messages from your local station.
This has been the Prudential Halftime Report, brought to you by Prudential. Prudential, a leader in insurance, investments, real estate, and financial services. See why Prudential is today's rock-solid choice for your financial needs.
Back at Madison Square Garden, Bob Costas with Doug Collins. First thing, Doug, this feels more like what an NBA game, especially a finals game, should feel like. 49-46, shooting around 50%, more ball movement. Not like some of the games we've seen in the past that actually are a concern for the NBA, but a concern for the Knicks is this. They play clearly their best half of the series so far, but their lead at home is only 3.
Well, they start Marcus Camby, picks up 2 quick fouls. They get off to a great start, and then San Antonio, little by little, just keeps wearing them down. And when we look at the first half trends, it's again Duncan and Robinson. You see their big numbers. New York shot 46%, easily their best shooting, but the Spurs 51. Sprewell, Houston, and Johnson 40 points on 30 field goal attempts, which is great. And more importantly, the Knicks got to the free throw line 2 more times. Allen Houston was 10 for 10.
We'll hear from Ahmad Rashad and Jim Gray and start the second half when we come back after this. And based on what we saw from Payne Stewart in his dramatic win at the U.S. Open yesterday, he may soon be joining Tiger Woods and David Duval on that Ryder Cup team. Always a part of our team, Jim Gray. Go, Jim.
All right, thank you very much, Bob. I just spoke to Chris Childs. He has a sprained knee, a medial capsule. He is questionable for the second half. I spoke to him. He's in a lot of pain. He says he wants to try and give it a go, but he's not sure how long or how effective. Ahmad?
All right, thanks, Jim. Greg Popovich very happy with his team that they're really not out of the game. They stayed close enough. Could have been blown out. Happy with Antonio Daniels. Also said they got to start pushing the ball up the floor, get out of the half-court game, try to get some easy baskets. Bob?
Ahmad, thanks. Here we go, quarter number 3. Ward behind the Johnson screen. Duncan takes him on a switch. Here's Sprewell with the jumper. Duncan goes to the floor, battling with Johnson for the rebound. Jump ball.
I think we really need to watch here in the third period also, too. Does Marcus Camby stay out of foul trouble? Looks like Tim Duncan there was holding his abdomen. And whether he got kicked or just strained something going for that loose ball and that rebound.
Duncan to jump against Johnson. The same size differential which has plagued Johnson throughout this series because of Nick injuries and foul trouble. Johnson has had to guard Duncan much of the time. The officials are just giving Duncan time now to catch his breath. And they have the ball boys mop up a little bit of moisture on the floor. But this avoids anybody having to use a timeout. Let's Duncan gather himself, and the Knicks get the tip.
But Tim Duncan was not ready for that. Looked like Larry Johnson quick jumped him.
Houston, off target. Camby on the offensive glass. Sprewell will try it. And Robinson clears it. Three shots on the first possession of the second half, and the Knicks come up empty.
And all jump shots.
Duncan is doubled. Ellie swings it around the perimeter. A three on the way, no good from Elliott. Back comes Ward. Sean Elliott has been a non-factor offensively so far through 2.5 games for the Spurs in the finals. Johnson's three isn't there. Robinson is for the rebound. Probably a double foul about to be called.
Well, you could see that happening all the way. Camby was bumping David Robinson as he's tried to get into the post. He started the foul line. David sort of grabs him. There's the contact, and there's the shoulder, and then they go back at each other. And I know they're both going to get a double technical here.
Double personal and double technical.
See, that hurts New York more than it does San Antonio right now because now Camby picks up that quick third foul. So he has been marred in foul trouble with his first start here all season long.
It's the second foul on Robinson. No shots taken on the double technical.
So they'll go inside at Camby again to see if they can pick up the fourth. He's got to be smart here and not leave his feet.
It's Robinson, and there's the foul.
That was an emotional possession that time by Marcus Camby that got him and his team in trouble, Bob. You've got to step away from the personal confrontation there. Two quick fouls, that's four. Now you've got to come in with Kurt Thomas. That's a bad, bad possession for the Knicks and Marcus Camby.
Camby fouled out of game two. He had five fouls and spent a long stretch on the bench because of it in game one. He's played 10 minutes in this game despite the fact that he started, and he's committed four fouls. The only good news for New York, as Camby kicks the chair as he's sent to the bench. The only good news, Robinson missed the free throw.
So he's got to be very careful. You kick that chair and the referee sees you. It's a technical. You're out of the game. You've already got one technical. He cannot get his second. He's got to be very careful here right now, Bob.
Sprewell with Elliott on him. Houston posting on Elliott. The fadeaway is good.
And very comfortable in that low block. This is the way they started the game. Now, after four quick jump shots, it didn't work. They went right back into the post as they started in the first period.
20 points for Allen Houston. Duncan out of the double to Johnson. Avery Johnson is off with it. Two in a row.
Bob, this is a mistake that some coaches make. They run a play, it works, they do something else. Keep running the play till it works. Make them stop it. Allen Houston really feels it in that low post right now.
Timeout
at San Antonio, Knicks by six.
See, I like what New York has done here. They got off to a slow start in the third quarter with long jump shots. This is the way they started the game effectively. Allen Houston fading away before the double team gets there. The next time down the floor, he gets pushed off the block a little further, but he's so confident right now, you're going to see him turn and square up. Ellie's worried about fouls because he has three. He has to give him some space, and Allen Houston is taking advantage of that right now. You see in the playoffs what Allen Houston has done. He has 19 points in the finals against San Antonio, but he has had to work so hard. Only three free throw attempts tonight. He's shot 10 for 10 from the foul line, so he has it all working tonight, inside, outside. He has 22 points on 14 shots. That's great efficiency.
The Garden's alive once more. Robinson with the lob for Ellie, but it's broken up. On the turnover, the Knicks come back. Houston, a pull-up, and he hits the three. And just like that, San Antonio calls a second timeout. The first three of the series for Allen Houston, which not only increases the lead to nine, but further ignites the Garden crowd.
Turnovers lead to shots in transition. This is where you have to attack. Allen Houston sees David Robinson is back. No need to go in there and challenge. You got the jumper going, just stroke it.
A 7-0 New York run, all of them by Allen Houston. You're watching the NBA Finals on NBC.
The NBA on NBC is brought to you by Brewery Fresh Budweiser, the official beer sponsor of the NBA. By Ford Expedition, the only way to get there. Ford Expedition, the Ford Tough. And by Nike.
New York has its Twin Towers, as you saw from the skyline view, but it's been San Antonio's Twin Towers who have been decisive through the first two games of this series. But now, as San Antonio puts it back in play, they trail by nine. The Knicks have scored 56 points. They've averaged 72 points through the first two games. Thomas gets in front, tries to break it up, and there's a New York foul as we check with Jim Gray.
All right, Bob, at the end of that timeout, Jeff Van Gundy went down to the end of the bench and spoke to Marcus Camby. He put his hand up around his arm and he said, hang in there, pay attention to the game, stick with it, don't lose it here. We're going to need you before this one ends. Bob?
Thanks, Jim. The foul was Kurt Thomas's third. Avery Johnson with the bounce to Duncan. Ellie will try it again. And finally, he hits one. It's a two-pointer. Check it. It counts for three. My mistake, he was behind the line. He'd been very cold with those open shots. Finally, he put one down. Ward on the offensive glass to give the Knicks a second chance.
A couple things tonight, Bob, that New York has 10 assists, only six turnovers. The first time in the series they've had more assists than turnovers.
Sprewell to Thomas around Robinson. It won't drop. Johnson battling on the offensive glass. And the Knicks will keep it.
But remember in the first two games how offensive rebounds were a factor. In the first game, 19 second chance points for New York. Only two in game two. They continue to get second shots. San Antonio is not cleaning up the defensive backboard.
By Thomas. But Ward's pass intended for Johnson is intercepted by Duncan. Robinson, tough angle, hit the side of the glass. Thomas clears it and Sprewell takes off at the other end. Sprewell. Again, Thomas wins the battle on the offensive glass.
That's about five offensive rebounds already in this quarter. That makes it about six right there. They're going to get Larry Johnson, though, this time with a push-off.
That's number two on number two.
Well, Greg Popovich cannot be happy with all these multiple shot opportunities that New York is getting. But they're going to give Latrell Sprewell that outside jump shot. They just don't want him getting to the basket. In this third period, he's not shot it very well.
Duncan, Johnson left alone with it. Now Sprewell comes over to help. Sean Elliott travels.
Boy, New York is very aggressive right now defensively. They're doing a great job rotating. And Bob, the reason they did not call that technical foul on Sean Elliott is he threw the ball into the basket because they recognized he was upset with himself. He wasn't trying to show them up. Once again, good officiating.
Crowd was screaming for the tee, but Dick Pivetta wouldn't call it for the reasons you cited. Here's Larry Johnson. He was fouled.
Before the game, Larry Johnson told Ahmad Rashad, he said, you know what, Ahmad, I'm not going to go for those three-pointers tonight. I'm going to go to the basket. And you can see he's playing with a zest that we have not seen. Now, his knee is feeling better. He's more mobile, more active. And he said, I'm just going to throw myself in there, and I'm going to make them call a foul.
The foul was Robinson's third. New York by seven. In game two, the teams combined for one less point than the Celtics scored by themselves in game one in 1985. That was the highest scoring finals game by a single team. Celtics scored 148 points. In game two in San Antonio, the teams combined for 147. This has more of the feel and flow of what an NBA game has always been.
Well, now remember, these two teams did not play each other at all this season. They're starting to get a feel for each other, what they can do and what they can't do.
The Knicks have hit all 14 free throws they've tried in this game. Duncan, triple team, ball not free. He's got it back, and he scores.
He didn't bring that ball down that time. He kept it up. The first time he brought it down and was stripped, that time he kept the ball up high. Again, Bob, one of the things you have to think about right now is with the foul trouble, Larry Johnson, Latrell Sprewell, Allen Houston playing heavy minutes. Will that take its toll as this game wears on?
Here's Larry Johnson, moving much better on that bad knee. Takes an off-balance shot that had little chance of going down.
They won't put him on the free throw line with that shot.
Sprewell broke it up, but Johnson is definitely closer to 100% than he was in the first two games in San Antonio.
Well, you got to give him a lot of credit because it would have been very easy for him to sit out those two games and say, you know what, I'm going to wait till I'm going to get fresh. But he tried. He tried to play, and he didn't get the results. But he is feeling much better tonight.
Mario Elie. Out high to Sean Elliott. Now it's the Admiral. Shot clock winding down as he drives and brings San Antonio to within four.
See, I think David Robinson confuses you. He's a left-handed player who really likes to go right. And I think sometimes guys get caught off balance by that.
David Robinson with 17 now. Sprewell had it stripped away, but it's out of bounds to the Knicks. Five on the shot clock. Avery Johnson took it away, but he was out of bounds. Sprewell fades, fires, misses. The rebound to Duncan. Robinson's pass is stolen by Kurt Thomas. Back come the Knicks. Sprewell to the rack, to the left hand. Doesn't get the roll, but does get the whistle. He'll come to the line.
Well, he's 0 for 5 this third period, all on jump shots. So he does what he does best this time. Drives the ball to the basket. And Bob, when you're aggressive, you put the onus on the officials to make the foul call. And that's what New York is doing tonight, especially here at home.
The foul is Sean Elliott's first. That's the first miss from the line tonight for any Knick. Tonight, when the game is over, the late night action heats up. The Tonight Show with Jay Leno includes Rob Schneider. Then it's Late Night with Conan O'Brien, and he has comedian Dave Chappelle. Leno and Conan coming up after your late local news tonight on NBC, and Sprewell missed them both. Mario Elie, Avery Johnson, Now Sean Elliott hit the side of the glass with it. Ball goes out of bounds, and the Knicks will have it.
Sean Elliott really struggling tonight. He had a really good look at that shot. They need him to take up some of the slack. With Ellie being in foul trouble here early in the game, it's been really Antonio Daniels that has done that.
Houston blows by Elliott. And then Dick Pivetta says, hold on. Greg Popovich comes jumping off the bench to dispute the call, a San Antonio foul.
Now, the reason that foul was called, because otherwise it would have had to have been a walk on Allen Houston, because he walked, but he said that Ellie pushed him from behind. That's why the traveling violation. That's why the foul. Excuse me.
It's Ellie's fourth. He has to sit. Jaren Jackson back in for him.
Not a very nice homecoming time for Mario Ellie. Comes home and gets whistled with quick fouls.
No, not at all. Won't like that on 97th Street between Amsterdam and Columbus, where his mom still lives. Allen Houston with a very difficult shot on the up and under, and it spills off. He darn near put it down.
If I'm Greg Popovich, the one thing I'm very upset with is the New York guys are going to the basket. They're not getting the defensive rebounds. Too many multiple shot opportunities in this quarter for New York.
Ward gets it back from Thomas. Here's Allen Houston. Jackson on him. 6 seconds to shoot. Larry Johnson on the move. He thought he was fouled from behind, but the Spurs have it. Duncan with a nice pass to Avery Johnson. Wow, what a feed.
Another one of those scoring drives by New York as San Antonio has upped the level of their defense. New York has not been able to score. And that cozy 9-point lead is back down to 2 once again. Larry Johnson, you think you've got the guy beat. You reach inside, and Tim Duncan with that wingspan gets a piece of this shot. Oh, he actually hit the arm. That should have been a foul. That ball popped loose. So instead of 2 free throws, they're going the other way. And Tim Duncan deep in that post with a nice give and go to Avery Johnson. The Spurs cut it to 2.
They've done it as New York has missed its last 10 field goal attempts. The usual complement of familiar faces at Madison Square Garden for Game 3. Peter Boyle, Billy Baldwin, Rebecca Lobo on hand. Two of the funniest men alive, Chris Rock and Billy Crystal. Allen Iverson led the league in scoring this year. Sun Yi and Woody. Mayor Giuliani has already presided over a Yankee World Series victory in the last few months. Would like to see the Knicks do it in the NBA. But perhaps not as avidly as Spike Lee, who might be the most fervent fan in the building. At least the most demonstrative.
Well, in that timeout, Jeff Van Gundy told Allen Houston, you got to come get the ball.
And he does, but misses. Chris Childs, we remind you, has not played in the second half. Banged up his knee late in the first half. Told Jim Gray he's in pain and wants to try. Van Gundy hasn't used him yet. Duncan spins with the hook and banks it in.
See, Larry Johnson has no chance down there. When that double team comes from the top and he spins baseline like that, it's too little, too late.
Tied at 58. New York led by 14 during the first half.
Psychologically, New York cannot let San Antonio take the lead right now.
Johnson out to Sprewell. Returns it to him for the baseline jumper. That's an air ball. The shot clock's going to run out unless they get one off here, and Houston does, and cans a big one. The shot clock kept ticking because the shot never drew iron. It was an air ball.
See, I think that's a big shot because San Antonio otherwise has a chance to take the lead. That would be devastating for New York to play so well and be behind right now at this juncture of the game.
The Houston field goal comes after 11 consecutive New York misses. Duncan finds Elliott, who's short with the 3. The rebound to Kurt Thomas. The Knicks had gone more than 6 minutes between field goals before Houston beat the shot clock with the big jumper. The lob for Houston and a whistle from Dick Pivetta.
Allen Houston going into tonight's game was 0 for 4 from 3. He has 2 threes now, and that big basket right there that puts him up 3. And Jeff Van Gundy says, hallelujah, we finally make a shot. Yes, sir. It's good coaching right there.
Absolutely. You run that drill all the time. Ball rolling free, only 1 second to shoot. Just fire it up. Thomas in the lane. The rebound to Malik Rose. Jaren Jackson, quick catch and shoot, but it's off. Duncan wins the battle on the glass. Fresh 24 for San Antonio. Duncan's pass eludes Avery Johnson, but they still have time. 10 seconds to shoot. Johnson runs smack into Kurt Thomas and travels in the process.
New York switched on that play, and you saw Avery Johnson had Larry Johnson. Thought he had an ability there to get inside, but the great weak side defense has Larry Johnson funnels him inside, and Kurt Thomas comes over. Could have either been a charge or walk. They chose the traveling violation.
Here's Houston on the move. It could have been a three-point play. Shot won't drop. He'll shoot two. Jaren Jackson picks up his fourth. The Knicks have scored only 12 points in this period. Houston has 10 of them. Game four is Wednesday night from here at the Garden, 9 o'clock Eastern, 6 o'clock Pacific time. The question is, will San Antonio be going for the sweep, in which case you'd have to like their chances to get it if the Knicks go down 0-3? Or do the Knicks make this a series again, and is this place rocking as they look to tie on Wednesday night?
Chris Dudley checks in, Bob, at the 141 mark for Larry Johnson. Why? You've got a five-point lead. Maybe you can buy Larry Johnson 2 minutes here at the end of this quarter and get him a nice rest so he can come back fresh. And you've got to tell Allen, Houston, and Sprewell, guys, you can't get tired tonight. You got to play.
After the two free throws, Houston has 30 points already. A minute 30 to play in the third. Duncan between two defenders. He was fouled. Meanwhile, over on the Knick bench, Childs does not have the look of a guy who's going to play. He's still in his sweats. The foul on Kurt Thomas was his fourth.
Well, this might also force Jeff Van Gundy to go to that big backcourt everybody's been wanting. They've wanted to see Sprewell and Houston in the backcourt together. He said, I will not start that team, but you might see some of it. Strategy right here. Larry Johnson, after about a 10-second rest, is coming back into the game for Kurt Thomas. Well, he picked up his fourth foul, so that's why he had to do it, because now he's got to try to protect Thomas. But David Robinson also resting here during this period of time.
While he was in there, Thomas had only 2 points, but he had 10 rebounds, many of them offensive rebounds. San Antonio back to within three, which was their deficit at halftime. Houston into the corner for Johnson, drives it back into the paint. Houston, good look at a three, doesn't go. Line drive rebound to Antonio Daniels. A minute left in the third. Duncan given room.
That's
the
illegal.
Bank is open for him.
That's illegal for a guy to step out like that and shoot that ball off the glass.
He's got 20. And it's a one-point game.
Bob, the Knicks need the lead going into this fourth period. They've got to score here.
Houston finds Johnson out to Sprewell, driving through a crowd, and a whistle.
Duncan loves this little mid-post shot as he turns, squares up. Chris Dudley's got to give him some time. He just faces up and kisses that ball off the glass. Bill Walton would love that shot. That's a John Wooden shot right there. Use that glass on the 45-degree angle.
After Elliott's second foul, Sprewell misses another one.
Trell is 0 for 3 here in this period at the free throw line. You can't give these points away.
Horrendous third quarter for Sprewell. 0 for 5 from the floor, 0 for 3 from the line. And finally, he hits one.
Do they go 2 for 1 here? If they do, they have to push it up. Otherwise, they want to get a good shot here. Pound it inside to Duncan. It's what's going for you right now.
Antonio Daniels, hot in the first half. Duncan in the lane. Dudley reached in. 3 second violation.
No, Greg Popovich is not believing that call. He says, I'm not even going to believe that you just called that 3 seconds.
Dudley out. Johnson in for obvious reasons as the Knicks have the last possession here, or what could be the last possession.
They're going to go high here with an isolation for Allen Houston. This is what Greg Popovich did not want to see a lot of. He's going to try to break down the defense or get a foul.
Johnson off the dribble, out to Sprewell. 3 seconds. Sprewell, tough shot, and he was fouled. It's on Malik Rose, his second. So Sprewell, who hasn't just cooled off, he's gone glacial in the third. 13 points for the game. Misses another free throw.
We see the last game 10 for 10. You can see when he's gotten to the free throw line. Look at his 19 of 20 the last two games against Indiana. 10 of 10 against San Antonio. So this is not like Latrell Sprewell.
Larry Johnson's going out, and with 1.2 on the clock, Chris Childs is coming in. Houston also goes out. They've got Dudley, Childs, Sprewell, Ward, and Camby on the floor. And he hits the second one. A second and change. It's broken up. And the Knicks will take the same 3-point lead into the fourth quarter that they had at halftime. They maintain the same advantage, even though they shot 4 for 22 from the floor of the period. Go figure. Back after these words from your local station. You're watching the NBA Finals on NBC.
This copyrighted telecast of the National Basketball Association is intended solely for the entertainment of our audience. And any retransmission, reproduction, rebroadcast, or other dissemination or use of this telecast, or of the pictures, descriptions, or accounts of this game, without the express written consent of the National Basketball Association, is prohibited.
This is a live shot of the Alamo Dome in San Antonio where thousands of fans have gathered to whoop it up and watch the game on the big screen. San Antonio, a gracious and enjoyable city. They have never had a champion in a major sport. The Spurs are their only franchise at the true top level. They've been there since 1973, have never made it this far. New York, in contrast, has multiple franchises in every sport. And in this decade alone, if you count New Jersey franchises, they've had a Super Bowl champion, 2 Stanley Cup winners, and 2 World Series winners. So despite all the noise here, what this would mean to San Antonio is something different than what another title would mean to New York.
Well, their whole philosophy is if we can keep this game close into the fourth quarter, we believe that we can win. That looks like an unforced error. It looks like Dudley hit that ball off Sean Elliott. That's just a careless possession. So you got a chance to cut it to one. You turn the ball over. See the disparity there in turnover. San Antonio with 15, New York with only 7 tonight. But remember, they only had 6 at the end of 3 in game 2 and had 7 in the fourth.
Fatigue, probably a factor in that number. Sprewell slices through, goes to the left hand, and hits a ridiculous shot.
Now, this is the same guy you said hadn't made a shot in the third quarter, right? You think he's going to stop shooting?
I doubt it. Highlight reel material there.
It goes by my philosophy. The only bad shot is the one you don't take.
And an offensive foul at the other end.
Latrell Sprewell driving hard to the basket, up and under. He actually shoots it under Tim Duncan, high off the glass with his left hand. Gorgeous shot by Latrell Sprewell, and then another turnover by San Antonio. The offensive foul on Duncan.
Houston. That's what he did all the time against Indiana and has been unable to do for the most part against the Spurs until now.
Well, Jeff Van Gundy said to him when he was in foul trouble, keep your head in the game. A tremendous dunk. More importantly, feel the crowd.
The NBA on NBC is brought to you by Miller Lite, taste a true Pilsner. By the Motor Trend Truck of the Year, the new Chevy Silverado, it's the truck. And by Warner Brothers' new motion picture, Eyes Wide Shut, at theaters everywhere, starting Friday, July 16th.
Now this is when Marcus can be at his best. This is what we saw. Now here he is right here. He's out of the play. But when that shot goes up, he attacks the rim. No block out. And this is what he did against Indiana, the spectacular plays. Another look as Allen Houston misfires on the little jump shot, but Camby, this is the seventh offensive rebound now of the half for New York. Now, he hung on the rim there. That's not a technical because he protected himself, and even if it were, it would not have been unsportsmanlike, so he would not have been ejected. Once again, we take the look there at Camby, and the crowd is excited. Bob, the Knicks have never trailed in this game. That's why they need to play ahead. They have not let San Antonio take the lead.
Steve Kerr brings it out of the backcourt, but not without some difficulty. Here's Sean Elliott, returning it to Duncan. Duncan cuts between two defenders, and the Knicks get it back. The turnovers are now 18 for San Antonio and 7 for New York.
Well, Duncan has 5, and they have 3 here to start this fourth period.
Houston. It rattles out. Camby trying to finish, and can't. Avery Johnson chases it down. Robinson. The Knicks all over him, and a foul.
That'll be on Marcus Camby. Bob, as he wheeled in there, he took both hands and pushed Robinson. Watch where his hands are now as Robinson comes in there. They're low. And the minute he wheels in there, you're going to see him sort of push with his shoulders. He's got his arms down. They'll call a foul every time that you push below the waist with that play.
And that is Camby's 5th foul. Robinson is long with the free throw.
Well, the poise that we've seen from San Antonio throughout the playoffs has escaped them here a little bit here to start this fourth period. We've seen uncharacteristic turnovers. Now the missed free throw.
Childs to the front court, guarded by Johnson. Houston out of the double to Johnson for 3. A whistle on the rebound. Loose ball foul on Dudley. That's number 2 on Dudley.
With Allen Houston playing so well, they've been forced to double team. So in essence, he's sort of their postman tonight. He's creating opportunities for his teammates out of the post.
Here's Duncan. Against the double, he goes to the floor. The shot doesn't fall. Dudley claims the rebound. Here comes Sprewell. Full speed ahead.
You better not backpedal when he's coming out. You better turn and sprint.
Sprewell nudges Ellie, and the foul is on Spree, his first.
Sprewell reminds me so much of a young Clyde Drexler. When he gets that ball, that head sort of goes down, and he's got one thing on his mind. Front of the rim, I'm not stopping. And a great finish there as Duncan just could not get there from behind.
That is really an apt comparison in terms of their play in the open court. Sprewell to Clyde Drexler.
Well, you know, Drexler used to drop that head. His chin would go to his chest, and you'd say, he's not passing, he's shooting.
Avery Johnson finds Duncan. The Knicks have 14 fouls already, so they're in foul trouble with 9 minutes to go. Kerr for 3, and he puts it down.
I saw the Knicks coaches there. When he hit that shot, I was like, oh, no. Don't let him get going.
a San Antonio foul. It's on Kerr. That's his second.
Steve Kerr gets up arm wrestling on Allen Houston, trying to prevent him from coming off that screen. Bob, one of the things now, Sprewell and Houston have not come out of this second half, and they're going to have to summon up all their energy, and Jeff Van Gundy's going to have to use smart timeouts to get them some rest at critical junctures. He cannot afford to take them out of the game.
Again, the 24-second clock isn't operating, so play has to be stopped.
This will buy you a little rest.
It's the fourth time it's happened in the game tonight. Van Gundy on the ropes several times. One story had him losing his job if the Knicks lost one more regular season game late in the year. Greg Popovich supposedly on the firing line with his team 6-8. Would have lost two jobs, coach and general manager. Coaching lifers, they both persevere into the finals.
I don't know if any coach has gone through more than Jeff Van Gundy this season and then has his team in the finals. It's really been an amazing story.
The lowest seed ever to win the finals, the Rockets, out of the sixth slot in 95, but they were the defending league champions. The Knicks come out of the eighth spot this year. And another San Antonio foul. The Knicks do not have the worst record of any team ever to make the finals. The 59 Minneapolis Lakers and 81 Houston Rockets made the finals with sub-500 records and lost. The Washington Bullets of 1978 had a slightly lower percentage than this year's Knicks and won the title over the Supersonics.
It's another championship we gave away in Philly, letting them beat us in the Eastern Conference Finals. Washington, we had vastly the superior team that year.
And the whistle's going against the Spurs here. Avery Johnson hit with a foul, his second.
Now, if you're Greg Popovich, your one concern is right now, you've got Mario Elie in the game guarding Sprewell, but Kerr guarding Allen Houston. They've got to continue to go back to that. See, Allen wants the ball at the post here.
Sprewell pulls up and is fouled as he releases the jumper. Mario Elie can't believe it as he's hit with his fifth. Hits the first, one more coming.
You see, in games one and two, New York has not been good in the fourth quarter, a total of 12 for 39. The points and the turnovers, a lot of that has been fatigue. They are running on adrenaline tonight. This crowd is carrying them, and they're going to need to carry them to the finish as Houston and Sprewell have played the entire second half. They're shooting the ball much better in this fourth quarter. No turnovers. 8 points on seven possessions.
Robinson with a hand in his face and the Knick foul. Exactly 8 minutes to play in the fourth. New York by seven.
Now, more importantly, that's the fourth team foul. So both teams now have four team fouls. So they're shooting free throws the rest of the game. Who can take advantage of that? Who will get to that line? Those are free points.
The foul was Dudley Stewart. Protection, as you see, over the hyperextended right elbow.
Saw Steve Kerr talking to Popovich. He said, this is the play they're going to run. He said, that's the post Allen Houston. So look for the cross screen to bring him to the low post.
Houston to Johnson. And he drains the three.
Two killer threes in Indiana to give him the 3-2 edge.
The lob for Robinson, but it's off his hands. Johnson. Fadeaway may have traveled and did. But But on the previous possession, here's what he did to increase the New York lead to 8.
Well, it's all created by the post-up of Allen Houston. You're seeing San Antonio is having a double team, and he's creating shots for his teammates. And Bob, we talked about in the open, his teammates have to make shots, and they are.
Robinson's jumper is long. Childs claims the rebound. Sprewell pulls up. Over the glass, out of bounds, San Antonio ball.
That was a little quick right there, Latrell Sprewell. Again, Bob, you got 4 fouls. You don't want to shoot that quick jump shot. Drive in there, maybe somebody will foul you. That's sort of a shot that San Antonio would like for you to shoot.
Robinson to Kerr. Houston up on him, shoots it over it, and it spins out.
Well, Sean Elliott's been over there a long time, and what's happened with this mismatch is they're going to go right back through Allen Houston again.
Here he is, and there it is.
Got to get Elliott back in the game. Papa's going with Kerr and Avery Johnson this long time, but he's got to get a bigger player on Allen Houston right now. He's going to score. He's going to get his teammate baskets.
Knicks by 10, and Houston has 32. Elliott left alone. Fresh 24 for the Spurs as it winds up in Avery Johnson's hands. Mario Ely driving, banking it in and coming to the line. Only Ely's second basket of the game. He has 5 points.
When you got a mismatch, you go to it and you take advantage of it. Chris Childs on the penetrating dribble, and he's going to find Allen Houston. He knows that Steve Kerr cannot bother his jump shot. So in rhythm, he knocks it down. And Mario Ely's, who's had more fouls than points tonight, finally gets a drive to the basket, slices between 2 defenders. We come back and have a chance for a 3-point play to try to cut this lead back down to 7.
And you're watching the NBA Finals on NBC. Two guys in this game will be in Sydney at the Olympics for sure. Allen Houston of the Knicks and Tim Duncan of the San Antonio Spurs will be on the American squad. But they're more than a year away from being teammates. Adversaries tonight, with the Knicks getting the better of it with 5:59 remaining, up by 8.
Well, you can see Larry Johnson has joined the party tonight. 67 of the team's 78 points. Houston and Sprewell have played very well. And, Bob, that free throw disparity we talked about has been very critical. New York has done a great job there. And they have 18 points off 18 Spurs turnovers. So 23% of their offense points off turnovers. That's the way you attack a shot-blocking team.
Mario Ely completes the 3-point play. New York by 7. Houston. Elliott right up on him. 5 seconds to shoot. It's Allen Houston dumping it off to Dudley. Will he have to shoot it? It's blocked by Robinson. And a 24-second violation.
See, Allen Houston got caught in the air. Had he not thrown that ball to Dudley, he was going to get his shot blocked. Now he's got the bigger Sean Elliott on him, so he cannot just overpower him like he did Stevie Kerr.
Duncan, Johnson, Mario Ely. Back to Duncan in the paint for the turnaround. It's short. And Johnson has board position. Houston to Sprewell. Nice catch and a difficult one. Now out to Dudley, and they'll set it up.
See, if Dudley catches that ball, he wants to get rid of it. He doesn't want to get fouled.
Sprewell.
You know, Bob, I can't even think that this guy would get tired. I keep talking about fatigue. This guy could play a double hitter.
Sprewell with 21. David Robinson, 7 on the 24. Sean Elliott for 3. Dudley takes the rebound.
Jeff Van Gundy says, keep attacking. Don't slow it down.
Sprewell. Went to the left hand, and it wouldn't fall for him. Avery Johnson comes sprinting back. Mario Ely.
to Robinson, and he scores, plus the foul.
That's another touch foul by Chris Childs. We saw it earlier in the first half when he did the same thing to Tim Duncan, and this is a touch foul. Three-point play opportunity. Avery Johnson finds Mario Elie on the break, and as he drives to the basket, he will make the nice little dish off to David Robinson. Childs comes over. The idea is good. The foul is not. And again, San Antonio hanging around as Chris Dudley checks out. And you know what? The statistics are going to say he didn't do a whole lot, but his presence was felt. This guy's playing with a horrible elbow right now, but he's doing a good job there defensively.
Camby comes back in. 23 points for David Robinson. That's his playoff high this year.
4 minutes here to find out whether New York is going to have a season left or they're going to be on the brink of being swept. The biggest 4 minutes of the season for them right now, Bob.
Allen Houston is double-teamed. Gets it to Sprewell. Only six on the shot clock, and he's out near midcourt. Sprewell finds Camby, who can't finish it, but there's a foul. You got to explain this to me. When you get up above the rim, other than trying to do it too emphatically, how do you miss a dunk?
I think you just said it. He tries to do it too emphatically here. You're so worried about the shot blocking, you try to quick that thing in there and you clank it off the back rim. That's twice he's done that in the game right now. And Marcus Camby now has to step up and make these free throws. But, Bob, one of the things that's happening down on the offensive end for New York right now is they're running off Childs.
The game on most of these NBC stations. It's your local news, then the Tonight Show. But for those of you who want to continue with coverage of the finals, switch over to cable and CNBC immediately following the game for a complete post-game report, which includes the observations of Bill Walton and Steve Snapper Jones. One of two for Camby. Sprewell on the move, tried to sling it back outside to Houston, and it's picked off by Duncan.
Bad judgment there by Sprewell. Got to stay on the floor now. You can't allow yourself to get so excited you turn this ball over. You got the lead.
Big one for Sean Elliott, and it's there for him.
That's a five-point swing. The two, you don't get an opportunity. Now the three, you give up. So instead of a 7 or 9 point game, it's down to four. Those are critical mistakes that you can't make when you're trying to win in the playoffs. Sean Elliott leaves his feet with nowhere to go. At the last minute, you see the long arm of Tim Duncan picking it off. The ball goes inside to the post. Avery Johnson with a cut. Sprewell comes in. That's his man. And he gives up the three. So that's a bad sequence there for Latrell Sprewell. You got to maintain your focus defensively here as Latrell Sprewell in this position right here. And on this cut, he's going to come in here, the kick out for the three-point shot. Camby had that covered, and Sprewell comes in, and Sean Elliott loves that corner three. You remember the big ones he hit against Portland in game two at home. And the message for Jeff Van Gundy to his team during that timeout, Jim Gray told me, was don't leave open three-point shooters.
Both teams have made 28 baskets. The Spurs have done about 58 shots. The Knicks on 74. Houston stays hot and boosts the lead to six.
He is playing like a real star tonight. He is putting this team right on his back. All the big shots have been Allen Houston.
And he matches his career playoff high with 34. Robinson out to Avery Johnson, trying to keep them in the game. Here's Ellie. Can't hit an open three.
Boy, very fortunate that time right there. They left an open three-point shooter. Allen Houston once again.
Larry Johnson drives baseline, finds Camby. His turnaround is there.
Some room, just enough for that sweet jump shot. And then the next play, Larry Johnson's going to penetrate on that baseline. Watch David Robinson. This is his job to come over and help. And Marcus Camby, with a spin, finds himself, gathers himself, a big shot to give him an 8-point lead with 2:18 to go here in the fourth period.
In 43 minutes, Allen Houston has shot 10 of 23 from the floor, a perfect 12 of 12 from the line. He's had other huge games in the playoffs. He's averaging 18 points a game overall in the postseason. But he's had huge games. The 34-point game in the opener against Atlanta in round two, the 32-point game to shoot the Pacers out of the series in game six, and 34 already tonight. Avery Johnson on the move. Blocked by Camby, but he's got it back. Shot clock down to 10. Sean Elliott now through the lane. Running one-hander good, and they needed that. It pulls them to within six with just under 2 minutes left.
Still plenty of time if you're San Antonio. You need to panic. You just need to play defense and get a stop.
Johnson's pass is kicked by David Robinson on a fresh 24 for the Knicks.
Well, they have need more of this from Sean Elliott tonight. As the shot was blocked, Avery Johnson gets it back to him, and the strong drive as he finishes it going over Latrell Sprewell and Marcus Camby. They need Sean Elliott to put some points up for them.
Elliott trying to contain Houston. Shoots it over. And the rebound is taken by Duncan. A minute and a half remaining. They trail by six. Avery Johnson needs it, but doesn't have it. And the rebound is taken by Camby.
See, Avery hasn't gotten many of those tonight. Now he has to take a big shot and really has not been involved in the offense tonight. So good defense that time by New York.
Sprewell against Ellie. Over it. And that may finish San Antonio. Sprewell, a minute four on the clock. New York by eight. Back after this from your local station.
A lot of double teaming in the post. If we can do a better job on their perimeter periphery guys, Duncan and Robinson get 45, we can still win.
It's Robinson. Ball knocked away, and he was fouled. It's Camby, and he's fouled out for the second time in this series. He scored 5 points. He had 4 rebounds. He was on the floor only 15 minutes. A couple of trends that have been apparently reversed from the first two games. The Knicks have shot 26 free throws and made 21. San Antonio 16 of 20. San Antonio had double the number, actually more than double the number of free throws through the first two games when compared to the Knicks. Here, the Knicks have been to the line more often. And the fourth quarter has belonged to San Antonio through the first two games. With the free throw by Robinson, the Knicks have now outscored them in this quarter, 22-18. 20-second timeout is taken. A reminder on NBC tonight, in most of the country, late local news than the Tonight Show, but if you want to switch over to cable, a full post-game report available immediately after the final buzzer on CNBC.
Now, if you're Jeff Van Gundy, one of the things you're talking to your team about is if they convert this free throw, Bob, it's a 6-point game. If we don't give up any threes, that's three possessions. They need three baskets to tie us. And so he's talking to his team, no threes, no silly touch fouls for 3-point plays. Use the clock and drive the ball to the basket. Get a foul. Allen Houston, Sprewell, attack that basket.
Here's the timeout situation. New York has three. San Antonio has only one left, and neither team has a 20.
We see 58, 73 points from these three guys. Remember, they've been averaging 72 in the series. That's a huge jump.
6-point difference. Pressure in the backcourt. They break it. Here's Johnson. Looking to use up some clock, and now they reach in and foul Johnson intentionally.
Tim Duncan said, I was fouling for 2 or 3 seconds. Why won't you call it?
A good point, actually. and it's Duncan's third. Johnson to the line for two. Taking his time. And the first one is long, no good. If he misses this, they come down and hit a three and do it quickly. It's a one possession game. Well, that won't happen as he makes the second.
With only one timeout, you're not going to burn it here. You want to try to get a score. You want to save it in case you have to move in the last 5 seconds.
Duncan. Out to Ellie. Duncan will shoot a three, and it's short. While Lewis Robinson recovers it, they wave the basket off. Loose ball foul on San Antonio.
Avery Johnson, the littlest man on the floor, got caught with the loose ball foul. Boy, the Knicks fans are feeling hope right now, Bob. We were all through this city this last few days, and it was 2-0. They felt they could do it. Now with this win, 2-1, they're going to say, you know what? We got a chance to even this series up now on Wednesday. It could be a new ball game. San Antonio has to start thinking a little bit right now about, you know, this Knicks team does believe in themselves. They have great confidence.
The Spurs are looking at their first road defeat of the playoffs and their first postseason loss since the second game against Minnesota. They had won a record 12 in a row, snapping the mark previously held by the 89 Lakers. And it would be only their seventh defeat in their last 51 games overall. Childs makes it an 8-point lead with 31 seconds left. If you had to pick a single play that was the most important of this game, it might have come in the third quarter with the Spurs making a move. The Knicks lead, which once had been 14 in the first half, was gone. The game was tied at 58. The Spurs have never led in the game. The ball squirted free. The shot clock was running out. Allen Houston picked it up, and with a second to go on the shot clock, fired a three and hit it.
Well, remember I talked about it was important for San Antonio not to be able to get the lead, that New York couldn't lose that psychological edge. And this has been the guy right here. Allen Houston got off to a great start in the low post. Ellie got in foul trouble. He used his size. And, Bob, that's the critical shot that you were talking about right there that kept him the lead. Catching, shooting in confidence. Out of a timeout, he comes to the top of the floor to stem another run. And Allen Houston growing up big time in the glare of the NBA Finals. See, Bob, if you want to score points, you can do it without shooting a high percentage by getting to that free throw line. And that's what's happened tonight. New York, 23 of 29 from the free throw line, almost 80%, only 10 turnovers. They have 15 more field goal attempts than San Antonio, 78 to 63. So even though they're shooting 40%, they're winning the basketball game.
Childs, who banged up his left knee toward the end of the first half, didn't play most of the third quarter, but has come on to get all the minutes at the point in the fourth. This Knicks team looks like a mash unit. It's not just Ewing out, but Johnson has been hobbling. Childs banged up. Dudley the hyperextended elbow. Second one won't go down for him. San Antonio with a glimmer of hope, but not much. Jaren Jackson has to force a three. Houston deflects it. Rose picks it up. Misses the layup. Curry cycles it out to Antonio Daniels, and then he throws it away.
That's it, Bob, right there. That did it. And you know what? It's going to be interesting. Let's watch the Knicks' body language after this game is over. They're still down 2-1. Should be no celebration. Walk off the floor like you meant for this to happen, that this is not an upset. I think you send a real message to the other team.
Prior to this game three, the Spurs have really brought the hammer down on their opponents, not at the Alamo Dome, but on the road. Teams that had played them fairly close in the first two games, thinking that when they went home, they'd have a better chance. Spurs got the ball back. They called an offensive foul on Chris Childs, but just as quickly they cough it up on the turnover, and now the clock winds down. Every other team, the Spurs have slapped on their home floor in game three. Not the Knicks, not tonight. There will be no sweep.
In fact, there may very well be a series now.
Well, you see the looks on their face here, Bob, and you say they knew that they could get this job done tonight. That's a look of determination. And those two guys, Allen Houston and Latrell Sprewell, were absolutely terrific tonight. They played beautiful basketball, answered every challenge that San Antonio threw at them. And Bob, I agree with you. That big shot that Allen Houston hit prevented San Antonio from ever getting the lead in this game. New York led from start to finish.
I'll tell you what, there are a lot of people surprised by this. There are a lot of members of the press who only packed enough clothes or sent out enough dry cleaning to get them to Thursday morning when they figured they were leaving town. We'll be here at least till Friday, and not out of the question that we go back to San Antonio. Right now, we go to Jim Gray.
All right, thank you very much, Bob. Allen, you guys played the entire game ahead. You never trailed. How important was that to this team?
Well, we did want to get off to a great start, and we thought that was important. In both of the games in San Antonio, we were trailing the whole game, and we just wanted to really stick to our game plan defensively, but, you know, offensively, we knew shots were going to eventually fall, and they did tonight.
What ignited you? You had 12 points in the third quarter, and you hit that big shot tied at 58. What got you going?
I just wanted to stay aggressive. You know, I think what helped is I got to the free throw line, and like I said, you know, we wanted to stay. We knew shots would fall, and we wanted to get to the basket. We didn't want to just not go to the basket anymore. And, you know, just God gets the glory for this one.
All right, Allen, congratulations. Great game.
All right, thank you.
Let's go over to Ahmad Rashad.
All right, thanks, Jim. Spree, tremendous confidence. Tremendous poise this evening. I mean, down 2-0. How are you guys coming here so confident tonight?
Well, we were confident because we felt we didn't play well offensively. We felt we got the job done in game two defensively, and we're rebounding the ball really well. So we felt if we could do some good things on the offensive end that we have a better shot at winning.
After winning tonight, how does that make you feel going into the next game? You guys feel even more confident?
Well, yes, we do. I mean, we felt, like I said, if we could just do the job offensively, that the defense and the rebounding, we had done a pretty good job in those areas. So offensively, Allen was great for us. He pretty much carried us for the night, and I was able to help. We got contributions from everyone, and that was the difference.
Spree, great game. We'll see you on Wednesday.
Thank you.
All right, let's go back to Bob Costas.
Ahmad, thanks. Doug, a quick closing thought.
Well, when we talked to Jeff Van Gundy yesterday, he says, Doug, I'd like for one time to play ahead in this game, in this series. And for the first time they did it, and again, as Allen said, they played from start to finish, and those two guys played the entire time. Fatigue was not a factor, and they were absolutely terrific tonight, and they have to make San Antonio think a little bit about what's going on now in this series.
The schedule, as we look ahead, we know for sure we'll be here at least through Friday. The game's at 9 o'clock Eastern time from the Garden. And game 6 and 7 in San Antonio, if it goes that far. Once again, the final score from Madison Square Garden, the Knicks 89 and the Spurs 81. Coming up next, after your late local news, it's The Tonight Show with Jay Leno as Jay welcomes Rob Schneider. Then it's Late Night with Conan O'Brien. For those of you who'd like to continue with NBA coverage, a post-game report is immediately available on CNBC. Quite a night in New York. For Doug Collins, Ahmad Rashad, and Jim Gray, I'm Bob Costas. You've been watching the NBA Finals on NBC. We'll be right back.